In this box lies the future of humanity as we know it. In this box lies an eternity of creative possibilities. In this box lies the knowledge of centuries, culminating in the ultimate computing experience. For this box contains...
Actually, it's just a laptop. About 5 years ago, I started to get into filmmaking, and I wanted the ease of use that macOS provided, along with the amazing beginner's tool that is iMovie. So in 2015, I bought a late 2012 Mac Mini. Remember the ones that you could actually easily change the RAM on? Well, that's what I did, instantly taking me from 4 gigs to 16. Eventually, I moved up to Final Cut Pro 10 and was even able to edit 4K video with no problems. I also used this machine for all my professional voiceover work in that time, and it never let me down and hardly ever crashed. Gradually though, it did begin to slow down, taking up to 5 minutes to start, even after a clear out of all my unnecessary data. It would heat up with the noise of a jet engine during video exports, and you probably could have fried an egg on the casing. Then in late 2019, it looked as though all my tech prayers had been answered with the release of the 16-inch MacBook Pro. On paper, it all sounded good. A brand new, or should I say old-style keyboard replacing the dreaded butterfly mechanism. A bigger, better, longer-lasting battery. A bigger screen with thinner bezels. The best speakers on any laptop currently available. 4 USB Type-C ports as standard, a minimum 16 gigs of RAM, and a 512 MB SSD. So I finally bit the bullet and went for the mid-range model, with the 2.3 GHz 8-core i9 processor, 16 gigs of RAM, 5500M graphics, and a 1 TB SSD. First, let's talk about the technical elephant in the room, that is the dongle. Like many of you out there, I bought this very expensive, very powerful machine, intending to use it mostly in clamshell mode at my workstation. But if I can't connect to monitors and devices quickly and easily without a hitch, that's a big problem. My Mac Mini had so many useful connection ports all built in, I just plugged in and I was ready to take on the world. But disappointingly, after 3 months with the MacBook, I'm now on my third dongle. The first dongle, made by a company called Ugreen, worked fine for about 2 weeks, then the Mac suddenly decided it didn't like it anymore. I get this on-screen message saying that too much power was being used through it. So I began by unplugging a few items that weren't in use to accommodate my sensitive MacBook. Then the Mac decided it really didn't like this dongle and closed down in the middle of a Final Cut Pro session, so back went that dongle. The next dongle, by a company called RCA, simply wouldn't work at all. I plugged it in, and not a heartbeat, so back went that dongle. Finally, 3 dongles in, I settled on a brand recommended by the Mac store called Satoshi. It's not the exact model they recommend, but so far it's working fine up until the time of this review. But here's the thing, why should it be so hard to get a dongle right, either at the Mac end or at the dongle maker's end? After all, can anyone out there remember ever having to buy 3 USB Type 2 hubs because the first two simply didn't work? Now let's look at the keypad. Obviously, I can't compare this Mac to previous generations as I've never owned a Mac with a butterfly keyboard, but so far this keypad feels sturdy and comfortable with enough travel. Now, I really don't care about the return of the physical escape key or the reconfiguration of the arrow keys, but if it's important to you as a coder or developer, I suppose you'll be a happy camper right now. Now, when it comes to the speakers, they are indeed impressive, with some of the best bass I've ever heard on any laptop. However, they're not that important to me in terms of quality because I'll be using this machine in clamshell mode most of the time. But if you are going to be using this laptop mostly as a laptop, then the quality of these speakers is of course a really nice bonus and is very much in keeping with the price you're paying. As expected, the Retina display is stunning with all the colours and nits that I'll ever need. There's True Tone and Auto Brightness if you want it, but personally, as a creative, I want to control all of that myself, so I keep them switched off. Overall, you don't get that much more screen real estate than you did with the 15-inch model, but the thinner bezels just look so much more sleek and up-to-date. As for the touch bar, well, it's there if you need it, but I don't. I don't require a time countdown of a YouTube video I'm watching, or a tiny graphic of my Final Cut Pro timeline, and I'm not sure anybody else does either. So far, I've only used the touch bar 3 or 4 times in laptop mode to control screen brightness or maybe volume, and that's about it. The touch bar feels a bit like the human appendix. It's always there, but you don't really need it. Apple claim 11 hours battery life for web and video browsing from this 100-watt beast. To test that, I wrote this entire review unplugged and watched a few YouTube videos every time I got bored, and I managed to clock up about 10 hours before the battery quit, which is more than I'll ever need. But of course, if you're using really intensive apps like Final Cut Pro, Photoshop, or Affinity Photo, be prepared to watch that battery life go down to at least 3 or 4 hours at the most. Now, when it comes to overall performance, everybody will have a different experience. It all depends on what spec machine you bought and what you expect it to do. The two apps I use the most are Final Cut Pro for all my video editing and Audacity for all my professional voiceover work. As Final Cut Pro is optimized for the Mac, I didn't expect anything else than a seamless 4K video editing experience, and that's what I got. As a test, I did a bit of video editing with fully optimized 4K media, and there were some tiny glitches, but to tell you the truth, I always work with proxy media anyway for the smoothest possible workflow, so no big deal. Video export times are at least half of what they were with my Mac Mini, saving me an awful lot of time. But given the specs and the price of this machine and the age of my Mac Mini factored in, they darn well better be. When it came to Audacity, however, I did have a few issues which still aren't fully resolved. For those of you who aren't familiar with Audacity, it's a great free third-party sound recording app. But after downloading Audacity onto my shiny new MacBook, I just couldn't get it to work. I spent a whole day checking every wire and connection in my studio until I finally remembered this little online learning resource called YouTube. It turns out OS Catalina no longer supports Audacity in its current form. But thankfully, there is a workaround. It involves opening up Terminal, typing a line of code, and opening up Audacity from there. So what's the bottom line? If you're a self-employed creative like me, then it looks like Mac have finally started making a laptop you can rely on again. If you're doing tons of layer-intensive photo editing or producing long-form content for a production house, then you might want to spec this thing out to the max. But the important thing is that the basics of this machine are once again on the right track. But Apple, please, just make your own dongle that works.